went to go see Wakanda Forever, I kind of expected to not be entertained. Like, I kind of knew, like, it was going to be some foolery in there. But I went there, and I was taking notes, and I was just going to share my observations, you know, with my channel and let people know what I noticed and what I saw. The Lord had me stop listening to secular music, and he had me stop watching things that were not good for me almost a year ago. So I don't watch certain TV shows. I don't listen to secular music. I don't drink. I don't go clubbing. You know, the Lord literally removed me from the world. So imagine me, you know, cutting all those things off for almost a year and replacing all of those things with church, prayer, the word of God, gospel music, worship music, and things that are pleasing to him. And then coming back and looking at something that possibly would have entertained me 2 years ago. And to see how I see it now is crazy, because I'm pretty sure I would have enjoyed that maybe a year ago, year or two ago. I probably would have found it entertaining. But now I was kind of just like, of course, the first thing I noticed was all the rituals and the ancestral worship. So, you know, in the opening scene, you know, they're doing the funeral and stuff, and there's a lot of chanting, there's a lot of dancing, a lot of ritualistic makeup. And, you know, in the beginning, you know, when they're surrounding his coffin, you know, there's shamans, you know, giving praise to the ancestors and acknowledging the ancestors as they're doing his funeral, and they have like incense or stuff burning. So like there was the whole rituals and stuff there. And knowing Marvel, they probably did their research and probably tried to make those ceremonies and those rituals as accurate as possible in their own way. So I'm pretty sure the way they did that ritual is probably accurate. Another thing I noticed was how the underwater kingdom looked very similar to demonic spirits and mermaids I've researched and seen in visions and dreams before. Minus like the blue skin and the Mesopotamian costumes, the slimy skin, the gills, the different color eyes. They look human in appearance. When you get too close, you notice that something's off. Speak a different language that's not necessarily a native language on land. So it's kind of just like, it was kind of weird seeing it on film. And I was kind of like, I'm sure there was a lot of research done on this as well, bringing them to life. And I just thought that it was very creepy that they looked similar to a lot of demonic spirits that I've seen in real life. Another thing I noticed in the film was that they were unknown to the world. Like, they were unknown, like nobody knew about them, but they knew about everyone on the surface, and they had a great disdain for people on the surface. They didn't want anybody to know they existed, and they had valuable things in their kingdom that they were trying to protect. However, you notice in the film that everybody on the surface is fighting amongst each other for resources while they're down there waiting for the opportunity to strike. Like in the film, you know, the underwater kingdom says all the time, like, they always had intentions to go to war with the surface. They were just waiting for the right time. They were just waiting for the right time to strike. And in the film, I specifically remember him saying that the machine that landed in the ocean was a sign of the times. A sign of the times. Time that they knew they were going to have to go to war, that they would have to come out of hiding and attack. Like, that stood out to me, and it sounded very similar to what's going on in the world right now. I also noticed in the film that everyone was poorly prepared to go up against this marine kingdom. Everybody was poorly prepared. Like, they didn't have the weapons, they didn't have the numbers, they didn't have the knowledge to defeat this kingdom. Like, they didn't understand how something that would kill an average human with one blow, they was eating that for lunch, you know? And they weren't prepared. And it reminded me so much of the world we live in today, where it's kind of like a lot of people are not going to be prepared for what's coming, you know, for the things that are getting ready to happen in the world. Like, and a lot of people kind of see these movies and they just like, oh, it's entertainment. But like, no, this is going to happen in real life. There's going to be a foe that comes forward that everybody's going to be looking around like, oh, my God, what is that? You know, and they're not going to be prepared, and they're not going to know how to fight them. And they're going to be totally caught off guard by what's getting ready to go down. And I noticed that in the film, like, These surface people wasn't ready for them. They didn't even know they exist. The whole time they underneath the water preparing, growing in numbers and just getting ready to strike. And we up here fighting each other over resources, not even prepared to go up against our true opponent, the true threat, the real threat. We not even ready for it. In the film, we also see that the Marine Kingdom has the ability to possess people. They have the ability to possess people with their voices. They let out some type of noise with their voices or some type of high vibrational frequency that sounds like a song, and it possesses their victims and it causes them to go into the water and drown themselves. Like, they didn't even have to leave the water to, you know, kill these people for real. Like, a majority of the people they killed themselves because they became possessed by the noise they were letting out. And if you do any research about mermaids and sirens, which are interchangeably the same thing, it just that sirens are supposed to be more evil than a mermaid. They have these singing voices that they use to lure people into the water, you know, that bring people to them. And people who have encountered them say that these voices are very hypnotizing and captivating. And a lot of people have lost their lives following the sound of a siren or a mermaid. So that was kind of eerie to see on film. And I can tell that there was a lot of research done to bring that part to life. Like, I can tell whoever did this film had to have done some research on some mermaids. Specifically reminded me of the scene in Peter Pan where Wendy was in Neverland and she came across the mermaids, right? And the mermaids were trying to lure her into the water, splashing her with water, tugging at her dress, and they later admitted to trying to drown her.
Wendy, they were just having a little fun, weren't you, girls?
That's all. We were only trying to drown her.
They wanted to kill her, right? They wanted to specifically drown her. And a lot of mermaids in real life, that's what they do. They try to lure people into the water, use their voices to captivate them, lure them into the water so that they can kill them. I know Disney does a very good job at trying to make them look fascinating, trying to make them look majestic, but these things are evil. Okay, they're evil and they're real. And if you go to any place like Africa or Jamaica, they'll tell you, like, we don't want no smoke with them and you shouldn't want no smoke either, and be careful. Another thing I noticed was the jewelry, you know, in the Marine Kingdom, in Wakanda Forever. And it was kind of like, you know, I understand that it was inspired by, you know, early Mesopotamia and Aztec and Mayan culture, but I couldn't help but wonder if they also did that because mermaids have an obsession with jewelry. And it also further piqued my interest because when Princess Suri went to the underwater Marine Kingdom in the movie, you know, she got this bracelet. And it was kind of like she was just really emphasizing on how they had such beautiful things and how their kingdom was just oh so beautiful. And it really made me wonder, you know, did they do that to try to accurately depict what a mermaid would look like and what the things that they like and the things they would be wearing, just with their own, you know, Mesopotamian twist. But that's just my theory. You know, we also see this, you know, in Peter Pan, you know, when the mermaids are really beautiful and they have these seashells and things like that, and how they were jealous of Wendy because she was pretty. You know, they tried to drown her, they tried to take her or whatever. And we also see this in The Little Mermaid, how she is fascinated by pretty things and they try to take pretty things and hoard them for themselves.
I've got gadgets and gizmos aplenty. I've got who's its and what's its galore. You want thingamabobs? I got 20.
And we also see this in Luca, how he would go to the surface and steal things that fascinated him. And in real life, you'll hear stories about people who have had things stolen by mermaids because they were shiny. And people on the native land will tell them, hey, don't wear shiny objects in the water. Make sure you put your hair in a ponytail because they will try to pull your hair and drown you and pull you into the water, and things of that nature. I don't know. That was just an observation. It could be a reach, but it definitely reminded me of mermaids once again. I also took note of what they were calling the king of the underwater kingdom, Namor. People on land were calling him our feathered serpent god from below, which was off-putting to even hear because y'all know anytime we hear serpent, we know its origins and we know We know. But I was confused in the movie as to where that came from, because not once did he display any type of reptilian features. Not once did he ever transform into an animal or make it seem like he had the ability to shapeshift. This man could literally fly. So I was kind of just like, why are they calling him a serpent? What's to that? Like, why are they calling him the serpent guy from below? When they went to the underwater kingdom, their greeting was this. They would do like this. So I thought to myself, like, oh, they're doing that because of seashells, right? It's a seashell. But then I thought about his name and how he is Namor. His name means without love. And they also refer to him as our feathered serpent guy from below, and how they had pictures of serpents, you know, in the kingdom below, and how a serpent's mouth opens up like this. Like, a snake's mouth opens up like this. So I'm like, and in the subtitles, they had the nerve to use a capital G when they were referring to him. You know, usually when they're referring to any other god, they use a lowercase. But with him, they used a capital. And I was just like, okay, this is kind of getting a little obvious, you know, a little blatant, you know, right in our faces, and a lot of people probably not gonna think nothing of it, or it's gonna go right over their head. The origin story also sounded very familiar to me too, and as I explain it, maybe some of you may have a thought or two, and if you do, feel free to drop it in the comments. But in the movie, these underwater people, the marine kingdom, explained that they were once human and lived on the land. They said, we once lived on the land. We dwelt on the land. We were not always in the ocean. And they explained that when they were living on land, that they were colonized, that colonizers came and they brought smallpox and they were killing them off with their diseases. And they were calling out to their ancestors and asking them how to save their people. Right. And they're like, how do we save us? And then all of a sudden, one of the ancestors came and gave them a vision and told them exactly what they need to do in order to save their people. That vision, the spirit tells him to go into the ocean and get a plant and make it into a liquid. And everybody that is still living is to drink it. And this is the only way to save your people. And so the shamans back this spirit up. And they're like, yeah, this is the only way. We got to listen to the spirit. We got to do what the spirit tells us to do. And so they oblige, you know, they do what they're supposed to do. They get the plant, they make the liquid, everybody drinks it, and the plant kills them. It kills them all. And they're on the island, they're all dead. And then when they wake back up and they're reborn, they are not human. But they also realize that they cannot breathe. They cannot be on the land. They are banished to the ocean. They are to go into the ocean, and the ocean is where they are supposed to stay. They can now no longer dwell on their native land. And even in the movie, as he's describing it, it sounds more so like a curse than it does help. That doesn't really sound like help to me, but nonetheless, that's their origin story. However, how did the king come to be? While they were drinking the concoction, the plant, his mother was pregnant. And so he was some type of mutant, you know, where he was able to be on land and he was able to be in water. And so that's how he came to be. But he definitely talks about how all the time how sad his mother was that she could no longer dwell on her native land. So much so that when the king's mother passed away, she asked him to bury her on her land in which she came from. It sounds like it tricked you and it cursed you, and now you gotta pay the price by living in the ocean for the rest of your lives. Like, even though you were able to dwell there peacefully amongst each other, like, you can never return to the land. And a lot of them had a desire to be on land, you know, even though they didn't like, you know, the colonizers or whatever, they still wanted to be home. Like, but they had to get used to and accustomed to being in the ocean. He also talked about a second son. He talked about how he was able to duplicate the sun for his people and bring it to the center of the earth for them. And it immediately gave me chills, and it made me think about the dream I had that I put on my YouTube channel called I Will Dim the Light, about a sun being at the center of the earth and the military finding it. About them finding it and saying, hey, we got access to it, and saying, we're going to take you guys there. And immediately I was just like, it's all coming together. All throughout the movie was just a bunch of rituals and ritualistic practices and calling upon the ancestors to obtain power or answers from the Wakandans and the Marine Kingdom. Like, they were always seeking out their ancestors for power, for answers, for something, you know, and it was just very blatant the entire time throughout the film. Only thing about the Marine Kingdom is that I believe they worshipped their king as a god. And then some people on the native land also worshipped him as a serpent god. And so it was kind of just like, just a bunch of rituals, a bunch of paganistic practices and things like that all throughout the film. And then towards the end of the film, you know, the Marine Kingdom just caused so much trouble for Wakanda. He killed the queen. You know, they killed Queen Ramonda, and still somehow, some way, Princess Suri was able to form an alliance with the Marine Kingdom and said, hey, look, I'll keep y'all secrets. I'll preserve your people, but this stops today. So they end up forming an alliance and, you know, whatever. But it reminded me of every other mermaid movie they make in Disney. Like every mermaid movie, Peter Pan has some type of alliance with the mermaids. They had some type of agreement. The Little Mermaid, they ended up developing some type of empathy. She ended up falling in love. They had some type of agreement with the mermaids and they formed some type of alliance. Luca, the movie that just came out in 2020 something, like they formed an alliance with the fish people and decided to protect them and not be afraid of them and to work with them and to live with them in unison. And I'm just like, it's a common theme, you know, with these movies where they're like, okay, there's an underwater people, there's mermaids or something, and they emerge and we develop empathy for them. And then we want them to live amongst us and be in alliance with them. And it's kind of just like, it always ends the same for every movie. And it's no coincidence that they released Luca in 2021, which was a story about a boy that was a fish, a sea monster in 2021. And then here we have Wakanda Forever in 2022. That's all about the Marine Kingdom and introducing to us Namor in Wakanda Forever and setting up his storyline. And then we have The Little Mermaid that's coming out in 2023 with Halle Bailey. And they're all about mermaids and fish people and things of that nature. And that's not coincidental at all. These are just things I noticed, things that I took note of while I was watching the film. Everything in this movie seemed very deliberate, very intentional, very specific, down to the terminology, down to the origin story, down to like the costumes and, you know, small details about, you know, the underwater Marine Kingdom. The ritualistic practices, the paganistic practices in the film. And I'm pretty sure there was plenty of research done to bring these things to life and make it as accurate as possible, to make it mimic or look like or be done in the same way it would be done in the real world off film. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if they had some shamans, some real shamans there to assist them with some of these things. It was just seemed like everything was very deliberate. Everything was very in our face. A lot of subliminal messaging, a lot of hints, a lot of like, you know, pushing the Marine Kingdom on us once again, pushing mermaids and sirens on us once again, and consistently doing so. Same type of storyline, us developing empathy and forming an alliance with them, trying to live, you know, as one, trying to coexist. I had watched this movie 2 years ago. My viewpoints on this would be very different. I probably would have even found it entertaining. I probably would have been able to sit there and just be like, wow, this is great. But because I haven't been in the world and because I don't indulge in things of this world anymore, the way I see things is totally different. You're still in the world and you still watch movies all the time and you still listen to secular music and things like that. Of course, your lens is not going to be like mine. You're not going to see it the way I see it. And that's understandable. I'm not here to convince anybody, just sharing what I noticed and what I observed. I won't be supporting any more Marvel movies or going to see any more movies. Like, I was surprised that the Lord allowed me to go see that one, but I'm pretty sure it was a teaching moment. And him allowing me to see the subliminal and hidden messages within the film. I just wanted to share that with you all, share my notes. If you guys notice anything in the film or you guys have any thoughts, drop them in the comment section. I would love to hear what you guys think. And if you made it all the way to the end of this video, I thank you for watching and hit that like and subscribe button for me. And I will see you guys very, very soon. Mwah.